Good morning, Lighthouse.
Good morning.
Amen, amen. At this time, I invite you to stand with me or us as we have our affirmation of faith, mission, and vision. I invite you to stand with me, everyone. You know, the Bible says, train up a child in the way that he should go. And when he grows old, he will not depart from it.
Amen.
Because if we truly look at it, we all were at one time children. Amen.
Amen.
So someone took us by the hand and worked with us. Amen.
Amen.
And so this morning for our affirmation of faith, we have Amelion. Amen.
Amen.
Let's make Amelion feel like we love him. And we're supporting him, amen?
Amen.
So we have Amelion with us this morning with an affirmation of faith, mission, and vision, amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now, our affirmation of faith, is Matthew 5 and 16. There it says,
let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven.
Amen.
Amen.
They did pretty good, do you think? But the question is, what does that look like? We say it each Sabbath, amen?
Amen.
So what does let your light so shine before men that they may see a good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven looks like? Well, I noticed this morning it was a little bit cool. Amen.
Amen.
And when I saw Amelion, he didn't have a jacket on, but his sweat hoodie says what?
Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father.
So what I'm going to do, I'm going to give this hoodie to Amelion this morning. Amen? Amen. The question was asked, what does that look like? Amelion was given the hoodie. Now he's looking for someone to bless with the hoodie.
All right.
See, this is an action thing. It says, let your light so shine that others may see your good works and do what? Glorify your Father who is in heaven. Amen? Amen. So as we come to church on Sabbath, we don't just say this, but we put it into action. Amen? Amen.
The mission of the Lighthouse SDA Church is to disciple and empower our members to be ministers who lead others into a meaningful and safe relationship with Jesus Christ.
The vision of the Lighthouse SDA Church is to be a
body of transformed Christian believers who embrace, nurture, and provide refuge for all.
Amen. 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 Please be seated.
Come on, let the church say,
praise the Lord.
Come on, put your hands together for God, amen. Is this a good day?
Amen.
Come on, is this a good day?
Amen.
Are you happy?
Amen.
If you're happy, you know, say amen.
Amen.
If you're happy, you know, shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Come on, if you're happy, you know, give them a high five. Come on, give them a high five. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Before we go into our welcome time, let me just give a few announcements. Get the announcements out of the way. As you know, October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And so we praise the Lord for those who supported the program on last week evening. But continue to wear something pink or continue to support breast cancer or any other cancer. Anyone dealt with breast cancer before or dealt with cancer? Anyone, you know, family, praise the Lord. So we're praying for you all. Also, please remember that our communion service will be on Saturday, October 22nd. So we want you to prepare your hearts for this, reconcile with anyone. Amen?
Amen.
But you know, at communion service is a day of celebration.
Yes.
Our communion service is always uplifting and encouraging, and so we want you to be here on October 22nd. So all of our ushers, deacons and deaconesses, elders, we will have our practice on that Friday, October the 21st at 6:30 to 7 p.m. Also, please know that we are having our Fall Compassion Outreach Project. This is what we are doing. I thank those who have brought your socks and any underwears to support the Shower to the People program. Amen?
Amen.
Our women's leader and the women's ministry is here. They are leading this project, and we are working along with them. So remember, every Tuesday you can bring some socks or bring some underwears, and then also on Saturday morning you can bring those donations and put them right there in the tote there in our welcome center. So I really appreciate that. Continue to support. Who says amen?
Amen.
Truly it's going to be a blessing. Also, we invite all of the members of the Lighthouse Church, those I know that you care about Lighthouse. How many care about Lighthouse?
Amen.
And this is our spiritual family meeting today at 3 p.m. At what time? Following our lunch, we want to be right here. It's going to be a time of worship, a time of prayer, a time of learning. We have a lot of exciting things to do, role playing, and so you don't want to miss it. This will truly be a blessing. So I'm asking it, all of the members to stay behind. Amen?
Amen.
And then also continue to pray for those countries that are dealing with Hurricane Matthew. I've heard from some of my family members. I haven't heard from my daughter as of yet. But we are still praying. I know that my brother, he lost half of his roof due to this storm, and over 800 plus people died there in Haiti. So we got to continue to pray. Amen?
Amen.
Also, the power of prayer. Amen. Amen. Our Connect prayer service at Tuesday, every Tuesday at 6:30. Every Tuesday at 6:30, we invite you to be a part of this amazing prayer service for us to connect with God and connect with each other and connect others to Christ. Every Tuesday. Well, family, this is our encounter worship experience. Amen?
Amen.
Truly, we have come to worship God, and I just want to welcome everybody to the Lighthouse Worship Center. This is a place of worship. This is a place of service. This is a place to what? Belong. Amen. Stand to your feet. Come on, stand to your feet as we just move around and as we greet each other in Jesus' name. Come on and let's go and greet somebody. Put a smile on somebody's face. Come on, praise them.
Thank you. somebody. Come on, shout somebody. With the voices of triumph. There's a healing in this room today. There is a breakthrough in this room today. There is a miracle. So let everything that has breath praise you, the Lord. I invite you now to stand just for our call to worship. This is our call to worship. It's on our screen. I'll read as the leader, you read as the people of God. God is our strength and salvation. This is the day that the Lord has made. Altogether, his love will never end. Praise the name of God. Amen. We have come to give God total praise. Lord, I will lift my eyes to the hills. Thank you.
it's very... easy to forget where our help comes from. We must always remember that God is our strength, a very present help. And what I mean by present, when you've had someone that you always depended on, and they have been afforded the opportunity to sleep, they can no longer be your help. I'm grateful, more than you could ever know, to have God in my life. But see, our trials and tribulations, they bring us closer to Him. If you let Him. He is the great I Am. And no man could ever be the matchless name of God. For our guests, it is time for our prayer and intercessory. Each week, we focus on one of our members of the church. To be fair, we go in alphabetical order. And I don't know about anybody else, but I am truly blessed to know that my church cares about my family and that they lift them up in prayer. And so our time today is for our own very own Dr. Salter, Elder Salter. Dr. Christine Salter, Victoria Salter, and Jonathan Salter. Amen. So we're going to ask our doctor as he swags on up here. As he if you have a prayer request, if you just want to give thanks to God, we ask you to invite, we're inviting you to come to the altar. My boss, my VP, was going through some things in her life, and she attended my brother's funeral. And when I returned to work, she called me in her office, and she said, "Who was that man that was singing?" did he work for the funeral home? I said, no. He's an elder in our church. And she began to share with me how much he had soothed her and blessed her because she was struggling with some things. And she said his powerful, compassionate, soothing voice gave her what she needed to carry on with what she had to go through. I will never forget that, Elder Salter, because you not only blessed my family, but you let your light so shine before me.
Amen.
So I know we text and you shared with me, you said your family, but I want to ask if you had thought about anything else that you are in need of.
Well, not me. I'm just very concerned about what's going on around us in our world, in our society, in our politics. It's just bewildering when you turn on the news and all the things you hear. And you hear about all the storms and the hurricanes and all the things that are reminding us that we're in the last days. So we need to be prayed up.
Those of you who desire to live, may do so at this time. Dear Father in heaven, Lord, first, happy Sabbath, and welcome to the Lighthouse. We know that you always reside here, O God, but we just want to acknowledge your presence this morning, O God. We thank you, Lord, for what you have done for us so far in our lives, O God. We are truly grateful, Lord, to have you in our lives. And Father, as you see your people gather here today, whether they are standing in this circle, or sitting down, oh Lord, you have already heard our cries, Lord. Your word tells us that. And so, Lord, we just pray and ask, oh God, that you would meet their needs, oh Lord. That you would show them how much you love them, oh Lord. That they would continually to thirst after you, Lord, and press forward to you, oh God, so that you may be connected to them like never before. And Father, we know that your love for us is not just for us alone, oh Lord, that we are to go out and share with others, oh God. So, Lord, as this world is becoming so dangerous that you can't even sit in your car or rest in your own home without tragic happening. And so, Father, we're praying and asking, oh, Lord, that you would use us, oh, Lord, minister to us, oh, Lord, so that each and every place we go, oh, Lord, that we would be so in tune with you, oh, God, that you would be able to use us, oh, God. You know, Lord, we as people, we are good with hiding what is going on inside of us, oh God. But Lord, give us the wisdom that we need to call out to our sisters and our brothers, oh Lord, to show them how much you love us, oh God. Lord, we want to lift up the families of those who are in Haiti, oh God. We're praying and asking, oh God, that they would draw their strength from you, oh God. We're praying, Lord, that when you send those people out there to serve them, oh Lord, that you would also send them out there to minister to them, oh Lord. They need that more than anything, oh God. And Father, we're just praying and asking, oh God, that you know that Pastor Hunter said that he has not heard from his daughter. We're praying, Lord, before the sun sets today, oh Lord, that she will be able to connect with him, or he will have peace knowing that his family down there is okay. And so now, Father, we come here with your manservant, Elder Salter, oh Lord. What a beautiful, sweet spirit this young man has, oh God. We're praying, Lord, and asking, oh God, that you would continually to use him, Lord, in the multitudes of gifts that you have given him, oh God. Give him wisdom, Lord, as he ministers to his classrooms, Lord, because though he is considered a teacher, an educator, a professor, Lord, we know that it is a ministry, oh God. We're also praying and asking, oh Lord, that you would watch over Christine Salter, Lord, as she continually to do the holistic healing of the bodies, oh God. We're praying, Lord, that each and every place that you allow her to step foot on, Lord, that she will continually to be that blessing that you have called her to be, oh Lord. Give her the wisdom that she needs, oh Lord, so that she can continually to show your people how to stay healthy. And then, Lord, we're asking that you would touch Victoria, Lord. We know that she is out in Colorado, oh Lord. We're praying and asking that you're watching over her, Lord, helping her to make wise decisions concerning her life, oh God, and that she is still trusting you, Lord, in her walk with you, oh God.
And Lord, then we want to circle around the block and go over to Jonathan, oh Lord. You know he has a beautiful ministry in music, oh Lord. And Father, you know the gifts that you have called this young man to be, oh Lord. And we're praying and asking, oh God, that he will walk in them by faith, oh Lord. Protect them, lead them, and guide them, oh Lord. Help them to not fall under peer pressure, oh God. Help them to stay strong and be that witness, oh God. And then, Lord, we ask that you look up on the Lighthouse members right here, oh God, who are standing in the need of prayer, standing in the need of whatever it is, oh God. Just wanting to give you thanks, Lord, for what you're getting ready to do. Here today, we lift up your man servant, Pastor Hunter, oh Lord, as he get ready to bring forth your holy word, oh Lord. I pray, Lord, that your family here will open up their minds and their hearts, oh Lord, so that you may minister to them like never before. So thank you, Father, for all that you have done and that what you're getting ready to do here in your matchless Son, Jesus' name. We are so grateful. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Told us in his tithe and offering. But I want to give you part two of that. When you rob God, you rob yourself of the blessings that not only that he has for you, but for someone else. For see, when you gave your tithe and offering in 2005, it allowed the conference to bring in a spiritual leader to be a witness to those of us who had never heard of being a Seventh-day Adventist. It allowed me to walk into the center out there in Forest Park and be ministered to have an understanding about what God is. So if you really want to know what your tithe and offering did, it was for me. So I wanted to let you know that when you gave your tithe and offering, you blessed me.
Amen.
So as the deacon and the deacons come to collect the offerings, let us remember that God loves a cheerful giver.
Amen.
Thank you.
Father, we just want to thank you once again, Lord, for all that you do. We are praying and asking, oh God, what we have given to you, oh Lord, that you will utilize it, Lord, to glorify your kingdom. So thanking you, Father, for all that you have done. Thank you, Lord, for using us. In your precious Son, Jesus' name, we're grateful. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. How many know that Jesus will? Come on, come on. How many know that Jesus will? It took the will of God. It took the will of God to die for the human race. That's God's love. He chose to love us. When we talk about Jesus' will, for months, my family and many of the members and the pastors, we have been praying for my wife to receive a full-time job. Jesus will, my dear friends. I said we've been praying for months. And it seems that God was delaying, but God was working things out. Just this past week, my wife had the interview and they called her in and said that they would love to offer her a full-time position. To be a consultant, an adjunct professor, and a counselor. Oh, just professor. Oh man, she's just a professor. Not even adjunct, that's a blessing. So we give God thanks for answering prayer. Because Jesus will. I heard the praise team, they did this song on last night. I said, you need to do it again. Because this song is going to minister to somebody. So Cabrina, come on. Now let's sing this song, Jesus will.
Jesus will. He's going to be our refuge. Why? Because demons tremble at the mention of his name, Jesus. Jesus. This worship isn't just a proclamation of you understanding and then telling God and serving notice to the devil that you already know that there's nobody, nobody like our God. Nobody like you, Lord. Say, oh, 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 oh. And you know what? Because it's a wonderful expression of our gratitude towards Him.
There's nobody. He's awesome. And He's faithful. And He's loving. And nobody. Oh. There's nobody like You, Lord.
And I was having some issues with my health. And my church family had a benefit. And the Lighthouse family really showed out on my behalf. And I love you all. You guys, your family was there. And you guys poured out a lot of love. And I wanted to share the testimony that came out of that benefit. The reason that my husband even had the benefit in the first place was because our insurance company decided that they wouldn't cover this medicine anymore that I needed. And so at first, you know, we're paying, using our savings, paying for this medicine that's, it's very expensive. The medicine could cost anywhere from $15,000 to $50,000. And so we're paying for this medication. It got to the point where we couldn't afford the medicine anymore. I was getting sicker and sicker. Doctors didn't think I was going to live, was going to make it. To make a long story short, the company told us that if we came up with $7,000. That's the lowest they would go to. $7,000, and we'll give you the infusion. So again, we have been trying to raise money, trying to get this infusion, and couldn't raise the $7,000. And we continue to pray to God, continue your prayer, trusting God, trusting God, trusting God. But one day I got a call from the CEO. This was after the benefit. The CEO of the company called me. I was blown away. I told Edgar, the CEO of the company is on the phone. What is going on? The CEO's on the phone. And he said, Jamela, I heard your story and I want to help you. And I said, okay, praise the Lord. You know, I'm listening. He said, if you can come up with $3,000, we'll give you the infusion. After the benefit, I had a little bit over $3,000. $3,000 is exactly what the offering from us before. And this is a company, mind you, that we had been on a payment plan with them trying to pay this infusion. So I owe them thousands of dollars. I owe them thousands of dollars. And the Lord moved on the CEO's heart, and that's the exact amount of money that I had to receive that refusion. Only God can touch somebody's heart. Only God can tell the CEO of a company to call you and give you the desire to want to help somebody that he doesn't know, who's not even related to them. Only God can show out like that. So thank you for your blessings. I thank you for your love.
Praise the Lord. There's no God like our God. What an encounter with the Lord. It's time for the word. How many need a word from the Lord? This is not going to be a sugar-coated gospel today. Right, sister? How you doing, Sister Chanel? Good to see you. I'm going to speak from my heart. That's how I always do. If I step on your toe, don't blame me. You take it up with the Holy Spirit. Because the Bible says that He will guide us into all truth. And the truth shall set you free. As I look around, I have friends and family members that are leaving the church. They're leaving the church. I even have pastor friends that have left ministry, that have left the church. And so you'll understand why I'm going to preach this sermon today. Let no one distract you. Don't even let self get in the way today. You came here because the Holy Spirit wanted you to be here to hear this message. How many of you love to hear truth and not a bunch of lies? Then you're going to appreciate this message today. You raise your hands. You agree. You love to hear truth. You don't want to hear a lie. The Bible says that the devil is the father of all lies. All lies. All liars. I don't want to be associated with the devil. I want to be associated with Christ, the truth. Well, I'm going to share with you truth from the Bible. From where, everybody?
The Bible.
From the Bible. Explaining why I am a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. Can I explain? From the Bible. Why I am a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. I pray that you didn't turn your ears off just now. But I pray that you're listening. We're using for our title. And take these notes.
Okay.
Write down these texts. This is our title. Modern Day Movement of what? Let us pray. God, we are in your word now. Holy Spirit, you are our teacher. We desire to be students of your word. Our ears are now attentive to your voice. Move on the heart of your children today. May we choose to follow your word. May we choose to follow your voice. Speak now, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
With the hundreds of churches and religious groups clamoring for attention today, how could anyone possibly discover the true church if God has one? Each of them profess to be a custodian of truth and God's representative here on earth. Yet, at the same time, each group is different from the others. The teachings of one church, for example, often vary significantly from another. Obviously, all of them cannot be right. Amen.
Amen.
My dear friends, it was never, when you study the Bible, it was never God's intent for the Christian church, for who, everybody? To be divided into different denominations. Each one teaching something different. God's word, whose word? Teaches something else. As an eternal principle, we do not go where? Come on, follow me. We do not go where? To find
the truth.
We go where?
To the Bible.
To find
the truth.
Because the Bible says that in the beginning God was the Word. And the Word was with God and the Word was God. He is the Word. And the Bible says that He is the way, the truth, and the life. And so we don't go here and there to find truth. We go to the Bible. Hello, somebody.
Amen.
To find truth. In this day, my dear friends, you gotta understand that when you found the truth of God's word in the Bible, then you find a church that squares up with the Bible and the Bible only. Today, there is a hunger for genuine Christianity. There are a lot of hypocrites in the world and even in the church. But there is a genuine, there's a hunger for genuine Christianity. There's a hunger to know and discover what, everybody? People want truth. Materialism has not satisfied. Pleasure has not satisfied. Technology has not satisfied. You gotta understand that there is an inner compulsion for something what? Solid, something that won't sink when we cling to it. And so, as a pastor, I've heard it many times. People have asked, does it make any difference which church I attend? I was not born a Seventh-day Adventist. I was born as a Baptist. I worship on Sunday. So what I'm about to show you is coming from God's word. Who says amen?
Amen.
And this is not to point fingers. I want to reveal truth, amen, and expose error. And so people ask me, Danny, does it make any difference which church I attend? Here we go. This study will help you discover a biblical profile of God's true church here on planet Earth, and it will show clearly that it does make a difference which church I attend. Throughout the history of the world, God has always had a people who followed him. He has always had a people who obey him. And they have composed of his church in every age. So our first question, because I want you to go back and study it. Amen? How does God identify his followers in the early formative stages of his people? We go to Genesis chapter 26. Genesis chapter 26, verse 4 through 5. Genesis chapter 26, verse 4 through 5. The Bible says this. I said the Bible. It says, and I will make your descendants, your people, multiply as the stars of heaven. And I will give to your descendants all these what? Come on, read God. Take it literally. He says, and your seed and all the nations of this earth shall be what? God is going to bless everybody, right? He's talking to Abraham. Why is he going to bless Abraham and Abraham's descendants? The Bible says, because Abraham did what? He obeyed my voice, and he has kept my what? And my what? And my what? And my laws. Let me remind somebody today that our obedience to God equals our blessings. Hello. Oh boy, the church quiet, man. Are you with me today? Our obedience to God, when we obey God, when we trust God, when we delight ourselves in the Lord, we will be blessed, my dear friends. He says, you will be the head and not the tail. You will be the lender and not the borrower. God says, I will build you up. I will bless you. Look at this. Since Abraham was faithful to him, God desired to acquaint the nations of our world with a knowledge of himself through the patriarch's family or church. Abraham's son Isaac passed God's blessing to Jacob. Jacob's 12 sons became the forerunners of the nation of Israel. The people of Israel was the Old Testament church through whom God sought to reveal himself to the world. God is so loving. So now, how does God describe his special relationship with Israel? Look at this. This Old Testament church, the Bible says this in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 6. It says, for you are a what?
Holy people.
Come on. You are a what?
Holy people.
You are a sacred people. You are a peculiar people. To whom?
The Lord
your God has done what? Chosen you to be a people for? A special what?
Treasure.
Above all the peoples, where?
On
the face of the earth. In the days of Noah, a people loved God, they kept his commandments and got into the ark. In the days of Abraham, a people loved God, they stepped out from the majority and kept the commandments of God. In the days of ancient Israel, the people loved God and they kept his commandments. And God called them his chosen, his special people. Throughout the Old Testament, Israel, though at times faithful to God, unfortunately drifted away from him. Let me remind you today that rebellion against God is self-destructive. Hello, church. Don't turn your ears off this word today. There are people who are being rebellious. They don't want to listen to God's word, especially when it calls them to make a decision, a choice to turn away from things that we call tradition. To turn away from things that we love to do, but it's not God's will for you to do. People fight with God. And then they try to even use God's word to justify their wrong behavior. That's the work of the devil. He used God's word to try to tempt God there in Matthew chapter 4. But God says, it is written. You fight error. You fight against the devil with God's word. And he says, my people who keep my commandments, my people who obey me, my people who trust me, my people who honor me. He says, you are a special nation. You are a chosen generation. And so, look at this. How does God describe those who remain faithful in spite of the rebellion of the majority? Never follow the crowd, my dear friends. Never follow the crowd. Look at this. The Bible says this in Haggai chapter 1, verse 12. How does he describe it? He says, then Zerubbabel, and who? With all the of the people obeyed whose voice? The voice of the Lord their what? I'm so glad, my dear friends. You gotta understand that the word remnant means those who remain. Those who what? A portion of Israel always kept their allegiance to God. Thus, by obeying the voice of God, they now form the nucleus of the New Testament church. So now we go to the New Testament church. And so since Israel's leadership, as we study the Bible, they rejected Jesus. When you read Isaiah chapter 53, what did our Lord say he's going to do now? What is he going to do? The Bible says this in Matthew chapter 16, verse 18. And I also say to who? That you are who? And on this what? I will build my what? And the gates of what? Or the gates of hell shall not what? Prevail against it. Beloved, you must understand that the rock in this verse refers not to Peter. It refers not to Peter, but to Jesus Christ. But to whom, everybody? How do we know? The Bible says this, man. You just got to search the scriptures. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4. It says, and all drank the same what? For they drank of that spiritual what? That followed them, and that rock was whom, everybody? So you remember when God brought the Israelites out of Egyptian bondage, the Bible says that he led them by a pillar of fire by night and a pillar of cloud by day. Amen? And so this rock that is following them is Jesus Christ. The Bible also goes on to say there in Psalm chapter 62, verse 2, he only is my what? Come on, folks, wake up, my dear friends. He is only my what? And my what? God is our only help, my dear friends. He is our defense. And I shall not what? I shall not be greatly moved. I said all that to say this. I'm so glad that the church of God was not built upon Peter as taught by some denominations. But it was built upon the rock, Jesus Christ. The church, my dear friends, has one foundation, and that's Jesus Christ, our Lord. This rock, my dear friends, is sure, it is steadfast, it is secure, and out of Christ flows living water. Out of Christ flows eternal life. Out of Christ flows everlasting truth. I don't know about you, but like the hymn writer, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is what, everybody? Sinking sand. Even when darkness seems to hide its face, on Christ, the solid rock, I stand. Even when my home life, my finances, my health, my education, the workplace becomes hectic, unstable, and overwhelming at times, like the psalmist, I say, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. How many thank God for being your solid rock? How many thank God for being your anchor? How many thank God for being a bridge over troubled water? He is our rock. So understanding that the church has only one foundation, and that's whom, everybody? And who is Jesus Christ? He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the word. That's the foundation. Here we go now, building the case. What instruction does Jesus give his New Testament church now? He says this, you can't see it there, but he says this in John chapter 14, verse 15. If you what? If you love me, this is what he's saying to his church. He says, if you love me, keep my what? Amen. Here we go. Look at this. Obedience. What, everybody? Obedience.
Write this down. Obedience is the natural response of a
heart
that loves home.
God.
And is what?
Converted.
Do you know there are a lot of people, even in the church, who are not converted?
Amen.
They are not willing to change. They made a decision. That's not for me. That's for them. That type of lifestyle is not for me. That's for them. That gospel is not for me. There's only one gospel, my dear friends. That's the good news of Jesus Christ. And when we accept the gospel and we allow Jesus to enter our heart, we desire to obey him even if it hurts, even if I have to leave my family and friends. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world, to gain popularity, and yet lose their soul? Nothing. God says, he says, obey me. He says, if you love me, you're going to do what? Keep my commandments. And so here we go. We know the commandments of God. We know there are 10 commandments. How many commandments?
10.
10 commandments. There will be people who tell you that the commandments of God are done away with. Well, hold on. Let's have some common sense then. Let's use common sense. If the commandments of God are done away with, why are we locking people up? For stealing and for lying or committing fraudulent or killing somebody. Then why are we locking people up? Can we use some common sense? Don't let nobody tell you that the commandments of God are done away with. God's commandments is like a mirror. It points out sin. It leads us to Christ. So the commandment, he says, if you love me, you're not going to have no other gods before me. In other words, you're not going to put anything before God. You're not even going to put your family, your husband, your wife, your boo-boo, whatever you call it. You're not going to put money. You're not going to put pleasure before God. He says, man, he says, choose me. He says, seek my kingdom first. People are trying to build up their own kingdoms down here. My dear friends, the Bible says there in Daniel that one day God is going, his kingdom is going to come and it's going to smash all of these earthly kingdoms. Only the kingdom of God will last forever. That's right. He says, if you love me, here we go. You should not make unto thee any graven image. You should not bow down to things that are dead. You should not hold on to things that have no power to save you. Some people can't go out of the host with certain things on. Hello? Don't you know that you're fearfully and wonderfully made? You're made in the image of God. So when I get up, I brush my teeth. I brush my hair. I put some lotion on and I look good for God. Come on, somebody. God says, if you love me, he says, number three, you should not make the Lord's, you should not take the Lord's name in vain. In other words, put some respect on God's name. Hello. Hello. In other words, my dear friends, don't tell a lie and say, well, God knows I'm telling the truth. Y'all know it. God told me, God did not tell you to do that. God will not go against his word. Number four. This is the problem right here. This is the big one. He says this is the only commandment that says remember. See, God is omniscient. He knows that, man, human beings, because of sin, they're going to play a fool. They're going to play like, man, I didn't know that. So God already put it there. And he already gave it even before he established, he wrote this 10 commandments down. Adam and Eve received God's commands to obey God, to trust God. And he says there in Genesis chapter 2, he says, remember the seventh day to keep it holy. 6 days shall thou labor and do all your work. But on the seventh day, God did something special. The Bible says he did three things. He blessed it. He sanctified it and he rested. Now, hello somebody, I serve a big God. I serve a God who's able to perform miracles. When you read the Genesis account of creation, the Bible says he spoke these days in existence. He said, let there be, but on the seventh day, he didn't speak. The Bible says all he did was rested and the day was created. Y'all didn't get that. There's something special about God's holy day. He said, I'll give you 6 days. You can go to work. You can be with your family. You can do all of these things that you want to do. But on the seventh day, I want you to set aside all of the secular work, all of the secular activity. And I want you to honor my holy day, because day one was not holy. Day two was not Bible says it was just good. Day 3, 4, 5, 6 was not holy. No one can tell you that, man, any day can be holy. That's a lie from the devil. You go back to the Bible, it says that it was good. But on the 7th day, he says, this day. He didn't need a day. He says, day 7 is holy. You honor my day, my dear friends. There are so many people. Let me talk to some of the Seventh-day Adventist Christians in this house. We got to remember God's holy day. Don't do your own thing on God's holy day. He says prepare for his Sabbath. That means you have 6 days to do all of your work. You have 6 days to get your food ready. 6 days to get your clothes ready for the Sabbath. 6 days to get all of your hair done and your shoes done. 6 days to do God's will, my dear friends. And not your own will. Some of us take God's day like any other day. God says, man, if you move them, you just trample on his holy day, God says, man, he will tear you down. He says, honor his holy day. Oh, boy, church choir. I'm going to preach it. I haven't preached for weeks, so I'm going to let it out. Let's go. It's more to go. I'm good. We ain't over anywhere today. He says, if you want to live long, he says, honor your father and your mother. Children, listen, it pays to be obedient. And then some of us are adults. We got to honor our leaders. We got to respect one another. We got to have compassion for one another. We got to look for one another. Who says amen? He says, if you love me, you will not kill. Some of us should have been in jail for life. But God's grace and mercy. But some of us are killing people with our words and with our actions. God says, thou shalt not kill. Here's another one. He says, number 7, thou shalt not commit adultery. Here we go. Sometimes we get on the young people. We think everybody, every young person is having sex. That's a lie. That's a lie. Some of us old adults, we having some sex now that we can't get pregnant, so nobody's going to know. Plain, hanky-panky. Just pointing the finger on the young people that there's some adults who are just going around, sleeping around. I know! God says, thou shalt not commit adultery. In other words, here we go, my dear friends. Not just sexual intercourse. There's some people who like to dry hump. You know what I'm talking about. Let's just start off rubbing each other. Let's just start playing with each other. He talk about also, it means oral sex. Don't play with God. Sex is sex. Some people are like, I'm still a virgin because I never had, you know, penis or anything. I'll just be real. Stuff in me. Sex is sex. Can we be real today? It will hurt you, my dear friend. He says, man, thou shalt not, if you love me, don't steal. Here we go. Can I talk to some people in this house today? Some people say, well, I'm not stealing from God. Well, you're stealing God's time because have you read your Bible? Have you spent quality time with God? Have you been intimate with God? It's God's time. We give all of the man or the woman, God's all of this energy that God has given us to go and work and study, but yet we give God half praise. Half worship. Thou shalt not steal, my dear friends. Also, hey, when the tithe and offering baskets come around, we look up like, how do we take care of God's house? He says, don't steal, don't take away the tithe and offering. He says, oh, hey. Number 9, he says, you love me, thou shalt not bear what? Oh, don't bear false witness. Don't lie. Tell the truth. Thou shalt not what? Covet thy neighbor's house. Why for what? Don't hate on me because you see that I'm being blessed. What's wrong with you? That means if I worship God, if I do God's will, I honor God, I know that my blessing is on the way. So when my sister prays God for giving life, I'm going to celebrate. When God opened up a door for somebody, I'm going to celebrate because I don't know if I just fall in line. There's something on the way. There's a miracle on the way. So don't hate on me because God is elevating me. There's some jealous folks. Don't hate on me if you see me drive a new car in the next couple of months. Don't hate. Say he's blessed. Can we just enjoy God's word today? So, oppress. It don't put us in bondage. The commandments of God makes us happy. Why? Because we know that God cares.
Yes, he does.
And so, you gotta look at this. James chapter 4, 17, very quickly. If anyone then knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is sin for them. Take God's word seriously. You know what is right and you refuse to do it, it's sin. Bible says, James chapter 2, verse 10, for the person who keeps all of the laws except what? Is as guilty as a person who has broken all of God's law. So people point the finger at that abuser, at that one who's molesting, as they point the finger at the murderer or anyone. We just as guilty. Don't point fingers, my dear friends. Bible says, take heed lest you fall. Sin is sin. Bible also says this, Acts chapter 17, verse 30, in some of your versions says, in times of ignorance, God winked. Look at this. Although God overlooked the ignorance of earlier times, he now commands all men, that's meaning everybody, everywhere to what?
Repent.
He says, repent. God says, I've come to change the way you think and the way you act. So now that I know that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, now that I know that commandments, the commandments of God, when you look at the commandments of God and you study this, you keep on coming, we're going to look at the character of God. The character of God is holy. The Bible says that his commandments, they're holy. The character of God, my dear friends, it says that he is faithful. The commandments of God, they're faithful. The character of God, God is perfect. The commandments is perfect.
Yes, yes,
so what is the New Testament church called? The Bible says, I write so that you may know how you ought to what? Where? Which is the church of the living God. The pillar and what? Ground of truth. Here's the best definition of the church in the Bible. The church of the living God is the pillar and ground of truth. In other words, the church is the custodian of truth, not error, and not false worship. Look at this, what this historian says. John Millard. I'll read it. It's taken from The End of Religious Controversy, that book, page 95. Page 95. There is but one inquiry to be made, namely, which is the true church? By solving this one question, you will at once solve every question of religious what? Controversy that has ever been or ever can be agitated. He says, if you solve this one question, which church is the true church? And here is how you solve it. When you find the truth in the Bible, you compare the truth in the Bible with what each church teaches, then you can discover God's true church. You must understand that just because a particular church's music is good, the pastor is charismatic, they have lots of good activities for the members and the community, or because you were born into this church and have wonderful friends in the church, all of these things does not make it God's true church. Why? Because if they are only speaking half of the truth, half of the truth, that's not God's true church. From Genesis to Revelation, God's true church speaks the whole truth and nothing but the truth. And they have a desire to live the truth. Before dying on the cross for the sins of the entire world, Jesus prayed that his church would be one. He says that they all may be one. As you, Father, are in me and I in you. Jesus told his disciples, there are other sheep that are none of this fold. But when they hear my voice, when they hear the truth, they will follow the shepherd. He says that they be one. What is the unity Christ prays for based upon the truth of his word? Unity is based on God's truth. So now, upon what is the New Testament church based? The Bible says this, sanctify them by your what? Your word is what? He says, cleanse them by your truth. Purify the body of Christ by your truth. Your word is truth.
So, as we continue to investigate, what two identifying features does God give His Last Day Remnant Church? Do you want to know how to identify God's true church?
Yeah.
Come on, family.
Yeah.
Because let me say this. There are a lot of people, as I'm studying this, there are a lot of people, they didn't even know what they believe. Not only that, they didn't even know why they believe it. And then, since ushering, they didn't even know where it's found. So you need to know what you believe, why you believe it, and where it's found. Because there are some whole lot of Holy Ghost people who are so ignorant.
Hello.
Can I just be real?
Be real.
They fail to study God's word. That's why when people come with these suit sayings and all of these nice talk and the way they put stuff and the way they put the word together, my dear friend, some of these things are a bunch of lies. But if you understand God's word, if you know exactly what God's word says, you will be able to identify what is truth and what is error. So now, here we go. How do we identify God's true church in the last days? How many know that we're living in the last days?
Amen.
Look at this. The Bible says this. Revelation chapter 12, verse 17. Very quickly. And the dragon. Who, everybody? As you study those verses, it will let you know that the dragon is Satan. It's the devil. Amen? And the dragon was enraged. He was angry with the woman. And the woman in Bible prophecy represents the church. There are two churches there in the book of Revelation. You have God's church, and then you have this false church. It's called Babylon. And Babylon is confusion. You know, baby Bibles, right? That's Bible. That's a bunch of confusion. That's how people are living. They're living in confusion. Who can understand foolishness? He has a true church, and there the devil has his own church. And so now he says they are angry with the woman. The devil's angry, and he went to make war with the rest of her what? And remember, back the first text we read, the Bible says that he will bless Abraham and his descendants. He will bless their seed. Why? Because Abraham's descendants kept God's commandments. And who came through the lineage of Abraham and through the lineage of David? My dear friends, Jesus Christ. And so the devil is angry with Jesus. He's angry with the followers of God. Why is he angry? Because they keep the commandments of God. And they have the testimony of who? So two identifying features of God's true church. They keep the commandments and they have the testimony of Jesus Christ. My dear friends, when you study the Bible from Noah all the way to Jesus, these individuals have kept God's commandments. Even while Jesus was there in the grave when he died for the human race, he kept the commandments of God. He rested on the Sabbath day. So what is the testimony of Jesus? The Bible says this. God's word always gives us the answer. Revelation chapter 19, verse 10. What is the testimony of Jesus? It is the spirit of whom, everybody? The spirit of what? The spirit of prophecy. So scripture identifies the true church as keeping one, God's commandments, including the Bible Sabbath. Not my Sabbath. Don't go around cutting. It's my Sabbath. It's my holy day. Hey, what you doing today, child? Well, I'm keeping my Sabbath. What? It's not your Sabbath. That's why people are in trouble today. It's God's holy day. So they keep the commandments of God, including God's Sabbath, as having within its midst the gift of prophecy. So now, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 7, look at this. So that you come short in no gift, eagerly waiting for the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ. They are gifts of prophecy, amen? When you read Romans chapter 12, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and also the letter of Ephesians, you will come across the gifts of the Spirit. Gifts of teaching, the gifts of wisdom, the gift of healing, the gifts of prophecy, and the gifts of preaching and evangelism. When you look at these gifts, my dear friend, they all come from one person, and that's the Spirit of God.
Amen.
The gifts are not to be used to divide people.
Amen.
Well, my gift is better than your gift. My dear friends, why are we competing with one another? The Bible says that he gave the gifts there in 1 Corinthians to build up the church. Not to tear the church down. Some people are fighting. Well, I can sing better than you. Well,
preach.
You can sing, but you don't have no spirit.
All right.
Yes.
Let's move on. That was a commercial one. So God's church will be a spirit-filled church that impacts the world. It's a spirit-filled church that impacts the world. God's true church, it is a powerful church. We will see miraculous healing from time to time in God's church if God so chooses. Let me pause right here. Let me lift up and brag on God. You know, Sister Turner Hunt, our father, has been diagnosed with cancer. And they said, man, he only has about a short time to live. We call in, we anoint, we pray. The brother's still alive. Amen. Prayer changes things, my dear friend. Prayer sustains people. When God says enough, it will be enough. You will see miracles happen, my dear friends. God will bless it with unusual prophetic insight. There will be dramatic breakthroughs in God's church. The Holy Spirit will be poured out. Thousands will become part of God's spiritual community. And so now, notice carefully the following biblical profile of the message preached by the true church as characterized in Revelation chapter 14, verse 6 to 12. Very quickly, what are they preaching? What is God's true church preaching? Is it preaching a bunch of foolishness? It's going to preach God's word. Look at this. The true church preach the everlasting what? Revelation chapter 14, verse 6. The Bible says, man, I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven having the everlasting gospel. What is the everlasting gospel? The everlasting gospel is that Jesus died for our sins. I say, thank you, Jesus. He paid the price for every sin that I committed. I say, hallelujah. Number two, the gospel, the everlasting gospel, that Jesus lived a perfect life. None of us in here are perfect. Some of us made mistakes just this morning. Matter of fact, some people just made a mistake just in their mind.
Hello.
But Christ lived a perfect life. That means, Sister Strong, he becomes our righteousness. He becomes our right living. Instead of people pointing the finger at me, my dear friends, don't point at me no more. Because my name is no longer guilty. My name is no longer cheater. My name is no longer adulterer. My name is Israel. I am an overcomer. Because God has called me. And so I walk in his light. I don't walk in the flesh. I walk in his light. I walk in his spirit. I walk in truth. I walk in holiness. I walk in joy. I walk in peace. I walk in long suffering. I know at times it gets hard. And I want to just lean to the right. I want to lean to the left. I want to do the nay-nay. But my dear friends, I got to stand my ground. And continue to walk straight. I'm preaching the everlasting gospel. Christ rose from the dead. That's good news. So that means, man, if I have to see death, if I have to die before Jesus comes, I shall live again. Because he rose. My dear friends, Christ ascended to the Father. That's the gospel. And he went to prepare a place for us. A better day is coming. I'm so glad the gospel says that Jesus is soon to come. Lift up your hands, O ye gates. Be ye lifted up. How many of you are ready for Jesus to come? I'm tired of this old world. This world cannot be my final home. It should not be. It cannot be. This world that we live in is filled with pain. It is filled with suffering. It is filled with abuse. It is filled with molestation. It is filled with all sorts of evil. It is filled with crime. It is filled with divorce. It is filled with a bunch of hypocrites. It is filled with the foolishness of the devil. This world cannot be my home. My home is up in glory, my dear friends. And I long for a better day. That's the gospel. Jesus is soon to come. What is the everlasting gospel, my dear friends? It says that the true church will let the world know that the hour of God's judgment has what? Somebody got to wake up today. Don't play with your salvation. Judgment must begin in the house of God. Judgment is going on right now. How do I know? Let me read this quote for you, my dear friends. The pre-advent judgment takes place at the same time that the final proclamation of the gospel goes throughout the earth. I am preaching the everlasting gospel right now, and God will hold all of us accountable. It says both have the same what? They draw a clear line of what? Between those who are where? And those who are where? Either you're with God or you're not. Either you're a Christian or you're not. Either you're following the truth or you're following the lie. No in between. Stop playing that game. These are the last days. And many people are going to their graves, dying in their foolishness. Many people are leaving because they don't want to listen. Judgment is going on right now. Look what the Bible says. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 13. Let us what? Hear what? Of the whole matter, do what? And keep his what? For this is the whole duty of whom? You want to know your duty? Your duty is to fear God. Your duty is to keep God's commandment. I didn't say it. God said it. Look at this. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 14. For God shall bring what? The apostle didn't see it. The elders didn't know. God is going to bring everything, whether it be secret or when it's done, whether it be good or whether it be evil. He will bring it into judgment. Why is God going to do that? Because remember, we are in the great controversy between good and evil, and Satan is falsely accusing God. And he's telling people, hey, God don't love you. If he loved you, he wouldn't let your loved one die. If he loved you, he would open that door and give you a job if he loved you. And some people have believed the lie. Don't you know God is fighting on your behalf?
Amen.
Don't you know that God has already figured what he's going to do in advance? I didn't know in 8 months, 10 months, that God is going to open up that door and give my wife exactly what she has prayed for. Two positions into one. You got to trust God. Don't believe the devil lies. And my dear friends, some of the things that we're doing in secret, we got to have integrity. We have to have integrity. God is going to expose. If I don't stop, if we don't stop, God will expose you. So look at it. To God's end time people, the word of judgment is what? Is it bad news? Those who are in Christ. Look what the Bible says. There is therefore now no what? To those who are where? In who? Who do not what? But according to what? You got to walk according to God's spirit. So those who are loving God, they don't have to fear the judgment. Only those who continue to live as a wicked person. Only those who continue to do, well, I'm going to do what I want to do. And when I get time, I'll make time for you, God. The true church will preach to everyone to fear who? In other words, you respect God. God is holy. God is just. God is fair. Matter of fact, he woke you up this morning. You're not telling your heart to beat. He's beating your heart. He's allowing you to pray today. God is fear. I didn't see God doing anything for me. Well, move your hands. Raise your feet. Matter of fact, breathe in and breathe out. That was free air. You didn't pay for that. So we better respect God. We better love God. And he says, do not only fear me, not be afraid of me, but honor me. He says, give glory to who? Give glory to God. Look at this. In an age of irresponsibility, God is calling for what?
More
responsibility. More. Today we're living in where wrong is right and right is wrong. Where you have the highest court here in America changing the law of God. And you have priests and pastors following this foolishness. Can I preach? In a few minutes. So how do we give glory to God? Because people say, well, I obey God. But this is how we give glory to God. To glorify God means to honor him in how we live. Both in our diet and our what? So we need to stop going to McDonald's and Burger King and saying, supersize me. Want the biggest bucket. Give me the biggest bucket to drink. Just give me a bucket. I'm going back home, my guys. Yeah. That got me, right? Well, some people say, well, I don't drink Coke, but give me Diet Coke. We gotta be careful what we eat. And then we gotta be careful what we're listening to. Because I know the beats are good. And some people don't even listen to the lyrics, they just listen to the beat. Just bumps up their brain. Be careful. I always say this. Be careful. She says, touch not, taste not, handle not. You gotta give glory to God. And also in how I dress. Especially when I come to the house of God. Hello. Don't tempt me. Don't cause me to lust. Can I be real? You gotta look at yourself in the mirror. Make sure that, man, I'm covered up, and I'm talking to men too. I don't need to see your chest. Help the brother out. I got one woman to look at. We got to honor God in how we dress as well. God, does this please you today? I know some people want to get attention. That's the problem. When you attract people to yourself, you lead them away from God, and that's why nothing works out. Start attracting people to Christ, and you'll see a difference. Look at what the Bible says. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19 and 20 from the Message translation. It says, or didn't you realize that your body is a sacred place? The place of the Holy Spirit? Don't you see that you can't live however you please? Squandering what God paid such a high price for? My brother, you're not getting any of this if you're not... Now we say, you got to put a ring on it. Hold on. Because we have the engagement ring. And we have the wedding ring. Now, which ring are you talking about? Just put a ring on it. Which one? So even when you get engaged, don't let him taste it. Don't let him taste it until you say, I do. Sex is good. Can I be real? Sex feels good. Sex was created by God. But the devil has tarnished sex. Now people don't even want to talk about it in the church now. That's why people are coming out of the closet right now doing their foolishness. Sex is good. But it's good when you do it the right way. It's good when you give it to the right person. Because I don't need to close down the blinds. Because when I'm naked before God, I am worshiping. Hey! Hey! God is not turning a blind eye. Hey! Because that's my woman. I don't have to run home. Get in the car late at night once we're done. Hello! Squander your own body. It's a high price. He says it's a physical part of you. It's not some piece of what? Belonging to the spiritual part of you. God owns the whole works. So let people see God in and through your body. People got to see God through you every day. Look at this. See what makes a difference? The true church preached to worship him who made what? Got a few more minutes, Robert's done. Don't, come on, listen to this. Don't miss this. We get down to the beat. And the sea and the fountains of water. So it points to the Creator. When we worship God, especially on this holy day, His Sabbath, we are saying to the world, God is our Creator. That God, we worship God in spirit and in truth. There are people who just want to worship God in spirit. But God says, here's the true church. They in John chapter 4. They are they which worship me in spirit and in truth. So he says, worship him. So now, here we go. This is where I really need you to listen to God's voice. Because you need to know what you believe, why you believe it, and where it's from. Here we go, very quickly. And I'm not bashing any denomination. You hear me?
Amen.
So far, I've preached from God's word. Amen?
Amen.
And God, when you read Daniel, God is in charge of history. He's in charge of human affairs. So now I'm going to show you something from history that is going to reveal God's truth and expose error. You're going to understand, I want to show you very quickly why the majority of the world, they are worshiping on another day. Yes, we can worship God every day. But the Bible says you have 6 days. That means I'm giving time to all other stuff. But he says, I want you to set apart one day, which is, and he established today, not us. We have no power to create anything. He declares which day it is and which day is holy from God. Look at this. Look at this. Write this down. Catholicism and fundamentalism. Fundamentalists, they are conservative movement in theology, this group that in the 19th and 20th century, and they believe, the fundamentalists believe, they believe that, man, every statement from the Bible are literally true. So look at this, Catholicism. And you gotta understand that Catholics, the word Catholic means universal. The Catholics, they have taught, and they believe that they are the universal church. That means all other churches that we have today came out of them. They believe that they are the mother of all churches. That's why when you look at the Protestant Reformation period time in the 1500s, you come across a Martin Luther, not Martin Luther King, Martin Luther. You got to understand, like their friends, that they begin to protest. There are individuals in the church, they're in the Catholic Church during that time. They begin to protest against the heresies, all of these things that are creeping in the church, like infant baptism, like purgatory. What happens when someone dies? They begin to say, man, they go to this middle place called purgatory, and now you can pray for your dead loved ones. You can pray them out of purgatory. Whether you can put them in hell or you can put them in heaven, you choose. They say all of this stuff. Then they talk about now you have to pay indulgences, all right? And now you have to bow down to dead saints, and you got to pray to Mary. You got to pray to Peter. You got to bow down to these images, and you see people kissing the hand of the Pope, because the Pope, they believe that the Pope is the Father, God the Father. They believe that he on earth, he is the vicar, he is the representative of Jesus Christ. But my dear friends, the representative of Jesus Christ is the Holy Spirit. He says, when I go, I'm going to send another comforter. He didn't say I'm going to send a Pope. That's why I don't lock myself up in a room and confess my sins to a priest. Bible says confess your sins to Christ, my dear friends, because only Christ can forgive. This is what they're teaching people. So now people are not longer coming to Jesus Christ. They're going to a Pope, they're going to a priest. And so now Martin Luther, they begin to protest. That's why we have Protestants. We are considered a Protestant church because we protest against heresies. We protest against things that are against God's word, my dear friends. Are you following me? So now, the Catholic Church, as I said, they believe that these churches, all of these churches came out of her, but yet there's some Protestant churches that, yes, they move away from some of the beliefs of the Catholic Church, but they still held on to some of her traditions. Are you following now? Look at this. So now here we go. Look at this reading now. Fundamentalists meet for worship where? Yet there's no what? In the Bible that corporate worship was to be made when? The Jewish Sabbath, and their friends, is not a Jewish Sabbath, it's God's Sabbath, amen? On day of rest, look what they say, was of course when? It was who? That decided Sunday should be the day of? For whom? Who are Christians? Followers of Jesus Christ. In honor of what? Now you should stop right there and say, hold on, bro, for real? Hold on. Because I was actually taught that. The reason why I worship on Sunday is because Jesus was resurrected. But my dear friends, when I began to study the Bible for myself, Jesus never said worship him because he was resurrected on the first day of the week. He said, how do you celebrate his life, his death, and resurrection? How do you do it? He gave us communion. This is how you celebrate his death. This is how you celebrate his resurrection. When you eat that bread and you drink that wine, it talks about Jesus as the bread of life. It talks about his blood has power to save. But
But Jesus never changed his mind about the Sabbath. Neither did the disciples, neither did God the Father, neither did God the Holy Spirit. And when you read all of the New Testament, neither did the disciples change God's holy day. But who is declaring that they have the power to change it? The church. Look at it. So, question you gotta ask yourself. Does the church have the authority, the power to change God's law? How do we know? Deuteronomy chapter 4 verse 2. Take this back to whomever and give them just God's word. You shall not what? To the word which I what? Nor do what? That you may what? He says, what? And do not take away. So does the church have any authority? But look how the devil is using people to go against God. Look at it. Look at it. Faith of Our Fathers, page 561, Cardinal James Gibbons. He says, you may read, they're telling us. But you know what? People don't like to read. You may read the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, all 66 books, and you will not find a single line authorizing the sanctification of what? Don't take my word for it. Look at this. The scriptures, what everybody? Enforce the religious observance of what? Of Saturday. Look at it. Canon and tradition, page 263. The authority of the church could therefore not be bound to the authority of what? Because the church had changed the Sabbath to... Who changed it?
The church.
Who changed it?
The church.
Did God change it?
No.
Did the disciples change it?
No.
This should make you look up and say, wow.
Wow.
Look at this. Not by command of whom, but by its own what? Whoa. So the question now, what is the foundation of your faith? Is it the Bible? Mm-hmm. Or is it what man says?
Come on,
the church has one foundation, and that's Jesus Christ. So when I reject the truth, I'm actually rejecting whom? I'm actually rejecting God. The church preaches against the mark of the beast. What is the mark? You're not going to get this literal tattoo in your head, 666. It's a lie. Some of us look at our cars and we see 666 on there and we say, oh man, I thought I got the mark of the beast. No. You will know when people are marked because you begin to do things contrary to God's word. So you have made the conscious decision, I'm not going to follow what the word of God teaches. I'm going to allow tradition to override God's word. You've made the decision, and then you'll get it. The Bible says you'll get it in your hand as well. What is it saying? That man, now I'm going to go and I'm going to use God's strength and all of his power to do my own thing. Trying to exalt ourselves without God. But the true church teaches, do not receive the mark of the beast. The Bible prophecy symbol number 7 equals what? And number 6 equals what?
Rebellion.
So now I'm going to make a bold statement with no apology, and I can back it up from God's word. You ready? Come on, wake up. I haven't preached for a while, so I'm going to teach. Hello. Look at this. God has a mark and the devil has a mark. God's mark is the Sabbath.
All right.
The Roman church, Catholic church, and remember, they said all churches came out of them, and yet some held on to some of their traditions, right? Their teachings. The Roman church mark is Sunday. Listen, my dear friends. Listen, you need to know what you believe, why you believe it, and where it's found. God's mark. How do I know? Ezekiel chapter 20 verse 12. This is just one of those references. The Sabbath is what? Between whom? God and his people. God will identify his true followers. The Sabbath. What is the Roman Catholic Church mark? Look at it. Look at this. What does the Roman Catholic Church claim is the sign of its authority or the mark of its authority? So clear. Catholic record, September 1, 1923. Sunday is our what? Bible
The church is above. The church is above the Bible. And this transference of Sabbath observance is proof of that fact. Listen, somebody. Why? The majority of the people doing this stuff on another day that God did not ordain is because of tradition, because of ignorance. But when truth has been exposed, we have to make a decision. Look at what they're saying, family. The church is above the Bible. Look at this. Perhaps the boldest thing, Phil, the most revolutionary change the church ever did happened in the first century. Look at what they say, Phil. The holy day. The Sabbath was changed from when? Not from any direction. Don't let nobody tell you a lie. Not in the scriptures. But from the church's sins of its own what? There is a way that seems right unto man, but its way leads to what? Death or destruction, my dear friends. Perhaps, look at what they're saying. Perhaps people who think that the scriptures should be the sole what? Should logically become. Y'all missed that. If you think that the Bible is above the church, if you believe in the Bible and the Bible only, not for my word, they are saying you should logically become Seventh-day Adventists and keep. Why? Why? The true church will preach the truth about the dead. We don't pray to the dead. Dead cannot speak. It will let us know that those who die in Christ shall be resurrected, my dear friends. My dear friends, the true church preaches to every nation, tribe, and tongue, and people. In Revelation chapter 14, verse 6, it will preach that it will be a worldwide church with a worldwide message for humanity. It says, go therefore and make what, everybody? You can stop playing for me, Phil. Of all nations, place of strength. Baptizing them in the name of who? And of the Son, and of the who? Holy Spirit. And he says, my dear friends, and teaching them to do what? Didn't it say observe some things? Observe just the things you like to do? He says, observe all things that I have what? And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. And I say, amen. My dear friends, to be a part of God's church, you must be spirit-filled. You must be fruitful. There are people who have not won anybody to Jesus Christ. Church quiet right there, boy. Because we all have our friends and loved ones. You have a responsibility to win somebody to the Lord. There will be no starless crown in heaven, my dear friends. This is a worldwide church. And so I close with this. So as I come to a close, I am a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. Because I have honestly studied the Bible and looked at the facts of Scripture. I want to be a part of a church that is Bible-based. And the Seventh-day Adventist Church is. I want to be a part of a church that teaches salvation is not by works, but by grace. And the Seventh-day Adventist Church upholds Jesus Christ. I want to be a part of a movement that follows in the footsteps of Bible heroes like Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Like Isaac and Jeremiah, like Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Keeping God's commandments and doing His will. And the Seventh-day Adventist Church does. I want to be a part of a movement that understands our bodies are the temple of God. A movement that calls us to glorify God in your body. Because we are physical and mental and spiritual beings. What we put into our bodies affects our spiritual life. I want to be a part of a movement that calls men and women just like Christ did when he said, if you love me, keep my commandments. Just like the Ten Commandments say, to remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy.
I want to be a part of a movement that I can look at the book of Genesis to Revelation honestly. I don't have to dodge text. A movement that is carved out by God. A movement that is shaped by God. I'm not interested in denominationalism. I'm not interested at all what man teaches. I only want what God teaches. My heart longs for the truth of God's word. And I've seen in the Seventh-day Adventist movement a church that is dedicated and faithful to the scriptures of God's word. You must know that God's church is not in the majority. You can never base truth on a majority vote. Did the majority go into the ark? Or were they outside the ark? The majority was outside the ark. In the days of Jesus, did the majority say, take that man off the cross? Or did the majority say, crucify him? Crucify him. He is not our Savior. Most of the time, the majority has not been right when it comes to understanding Bible truth. God's church, my dear friends, is not the most popular. Truth rarely wins a popularity contest. God's church is not the most spectacular. God values truth more than architecture. God's church does not need the approval of popular religious leaders. Truth is truth, whether religious leaders accept it as truth or not. The real issue is not what some religious leader thinks. The real issue is what is in God's word. What does Jesus say? And the question in God's final judgment is not what did your pastor, your bishop, your reverend, your priest say. It is what did Jesus say to convict your heart. Jesus says, and you shall know the truth. And the truth shall make you free. Thank God for freedom. Thank God for life return. Thank God for a word that can set me free. And the Bible says, and when the Spirit of truth comes, it beckons us to follow it. It burns in our soul. Number three, it frees us from error. And number four, it demands we take a stand. Who will you follow today? Our choice today, will we follow the Bible or will we follow tradition? Many of us have our own traditions and we try to make it biblical. But the Bible is above tradition. Do you choose Jesus today or do you choose a religious leader? Do you choose God's law or do you choose man's dogmas? Do you choose God's instructions or do you choose human teaching? Do you choose God's way or do you choose man's way? My choice is to follow God all the way. Is this your choice today? You can raise your hand. Is this your choice today? Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed today. Father, we thank you for being our foundation. For many, this is a hard word. But at the same time, it is a good word. God, you have come to show us the light. You said to the law and to the testimony, they speak not according to your word. It's because there's no light in them. But today, Holy Spirit, your word brought light in this house today. Thank you for being the light of the world. Thank you for showing us our dark ways. Thank you for revealing to us the things we need to believe. Thank you for giving us wisdom to understand your word. Now, God, the test will come. Will we follow your word or will we go back to the way of living? Will we go back to the teachings of human beings? Will we trust man's dogmas? Will we put our tradition above your word? Or will we walk away from tradition to follow you all the way in Bible truth? Your people raise their hands today. That means none of us will be ignorant. That means you will hold all of us accountable to what we have heard. Now you expect us to walk in truth. You expect us not to go back to the things that have entangled us. There are some things we need to let go. And I want to pray a special prayer for somebody. Someone in here is dealing with an issue. And you need God to give you the breakthrough. You need God to come to your defense. You've tried to do it on your own. And your own way have failed you. But today I'm asking you to try Jesus. If there's someone in this house and you want to try Jesus, I want to pray a special prayer. And don't sit in your seat. I want you to come. You know what you're going through. You need God to do it. So walking down here saying, God, I surrender. I release this issue to you. So I'm asking you to come. I want to pray a prayer for you. I know there's someone in here dealing with an issue. Hallelujah. Come and put your hands together. Hallelujah. He's coming. I know there's someone else. You're dealing with an issue. You need this breakthrough. Don't stay in your seat. I want to pray this prayer over you today. It's not a long prayer, it's a short prayer. This is the day of your freedom. This is the day of your release. This is a day that God is going to break those chains. Come on, I know there's somebody else in here. There's a stronghold in your life. There's a stronghold in your life. You can join these others who have come saying, Lord, I surrender. I give you it all. I give all to you. Is there anybody else? Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray your covering upon this generation. Those that are in their seats and those that have come forth. I pray, oh God, in the name of Jesus, that you lift up a standard against the enemy. Release your people, oh God, from the things that are holding them down. Release them from every bad addiction right now, God. There's some who are dealing with some mental issues. But in the name of Jesus, give them the mind of Christ. Change the way they think. Change their behavior, oh God. And give them the power, oh God, to turn away, to find freedom in you, God. Father, I'm praying for those who are dealing with some emotional pain. There are those who are dealing with physical pain. There are those who are dealing with spiritual pain. In the name of Jesus, Spirit of the living God, fall upon all flesh right now. I pray, oh God, that your hands of mercy be upon your children. I pray, oh God, that you give them your joy. I pray, oh God, that you give them peace of mind. I pray, oh God, that you breathe healing upon this generation, oh God. Take away generational curses right now, God. Release them in the name of Jesus, God. We surrender to you, Lord. Father, we desire not to go back to our old way of living. But we desire to walk in newness of life. And so, oh God, we surrender. Order our steps, oh God. Bless this young man. Bless these women. Bless these children that have come forth, oh God. You know the needs. You know the hearts of your children. Search our hearts, oh God. Make us pure, oh God. Cleanse the body of Christ. I pray, oh God, that you'll open up shut doors in individual lives, oh God. And I pray, oh God, that you'll shut doors that we don't need to walk into, oh God. I pray, oh God, that you'll give us new insight. I pray, oh God, that you'll give us the obedient heart, oh God. I pray that we'll lean that to our own understanding, but in every situation we'll acknowledge you as God. God, some of us have to walk away from tradition. Some of us have to leave some family and friends behind to follow you all the way in truth. So give us Holy Ghost boldness, oh God, to not go back to tradition, to not go back to false worship, but to worship you in spirit and in truth. Bless this congregation. And I pray, oh God, that you'll wash our sins away. And that way, the way you're going to wash our sins, oh God, some of us need to be baptized. Baptism is just a public declaration that I surrender to God. I desire to experience a spiritual rebirth through water baptism. God, there's someone today that needs to be baptized. There's someone today that needs to be rebaptized. They've walked away from you, oh God. They've done their own thing. They've committed sin, oh God. But today you can cleanse them. So if there's someone in this house, before I close this prayer, that desired to be baptized or rebaptized, just raise your hand. We will schedule that baptism. Just raise your hand and put it back down. Hallelujah, God. There's two individuals. Hallelujah. We will schedule a baptism. Come on, put your hands together.